Good morning, everyone. Welcome to this webinar, UK, EU exit, what next? Pleased to see so many who has tuned in and that we have such a strong panel of speakers and advisors in the room today. My name is Gunnar Larsen and I'm from the Danish-UK Association. On behalf of our colleagues from the British Chamber of Commerce in Denmark, welcome and thank you for being part of this. Just a few house rules for this event. Firstly, the webinar will be recorded and will be shared with you afterwards. The recording will only be of the main first hour part of the webinar. Once we go into the breakout rooms later, that will not be recorded and reshared. However, on the practical matter, once you get into the breakouts and if there are any specific questions you need to follow up upon, with the people in the room, then come back to me or any of my colleagues from the two chambers, the British Chamber of Commerce or the Danish-UK Association. Moving on, I would like to introduce you to our moderator. So the whole topic around UK, EU, what next? Well, we thought we may have had some ideas to what next going on right now. However, there's still a lot to be discussed, we can see. And therefore, and we already knew that's going to be happening once we planned this event a month ago, that there's still going to be a lot of uncertainties, there's still going to be a need for a lot of reaffirmation, and there's still going to be a lot of confusion and questions to how we do that because it's new to us all. It doesn't matter whether you are an EU country like Denmark or whether the United Kingdom, who is no longer part of the EU, we need to find out how we keep on trading. And that is the whole purpose of this webinar, is that we give a platform where you as an individual, as a company who are trading across the North Sea, you can still find ways you can do so. And that's why you have organizations like the British Chamber and the DKUK to help facilitate that. And today we have a panel of three of the leading legal firms from Denmark and the United Kingdom, and we have a moderated by Kasper Barfod. Kasper, he is the country director of Department for International Trade, so the UK's department that helps promoting trade and investment to and from the United Kingdom. He is on a daily basis based in at the British Embassy in Copenhagen. He joined the embassy back in 2018, but already then came with 30 years of experience from private sectors, and indeed have also had a lot of experience about doing international trades. He himself has been outside of Denmark for a good 14 years in Germany and for that sake also the UK. So having a person like this as a moderator really puts us in a good place because DIT, of course, one, they are advising UK companies, but they're also advising Danish companies who may want to invest in the UK and therefore see some of the problem scenarios. Now, just a quick on the house rules, I can hear there's a little bit of a feedback. If I can ask everyone, please to mute your microphones, that will make it a lot easier. There will be a time for questions in this. So Kasper, he has set up a number of questions he knows is very pertinent, very relevant as we are standing right now. However, if you have any question at that very moment in time that is very relevant, then please do fill them in through the chat function. And I'll keep an eye on those and I will field them to Kasper. If not, we will try to revisit those questions during the Q&A at the end or in the breakout rooms. More about the breakout rooms on top of the hour. Kira from the British Chamber, she will come back and tell you all about how that works. But with this, Kasper, can I ask you to unmute yourself and take it from here, please? Welcome, Kasper.
Thank you very much, Gunnar, and thank you for giving me the opportunity to moderate this session, and thank you for hosting the session. At DIT, what we've been asked to do for the past couple of months is to help keep business moving between the UK and Denmark, and of course colleagues across Europe has had the same ask, so we have very actively been participating in these kinds of events. We also have two very large events. So if you go to the .gov.uk homepage or DIT's homepage, you'll see that we have some mass outreach events planned for this week. I think Tuesday and Wednesday from memory. The format today is what's being described, maybe for lack of a better word, as a fireside chat. but I'll be moderating and asking questions to our three participants, all with legal backgrounds. I think I had a dog barking in the background here, sorry for that. But this is what happens in these times that we are currently in. First of all, we have Andrew Poole from the law firm Goison and Federspiel. And then I'm hoping that we have Bernardine Adkins. I don't seem to see her on screen. Are you there, Bernardine?
Yes, I'm here. Sorry, I'm here. Okay.
No worries, then it's just my screen. I just wanted to make sure. And Bernardine is from the legal firm Gowling. And then finally, we have Thuy Rasmussen from Kromann and Reumert. What we want to focus on here is business preparedness for end of transition period. And those are sort of the main questions that I'm going to talk about. Of course, it's impossible not to just touch very briefly on where are we. And I'm sure that all of you who participate in this webinar have a strong interest in end of transition period, which is what we call it, because Brexit happened by the end of January this year. And now we're coming to the end of the transition period. And we will all have seen that the EU and the UK have decided to continue negotiating until the very last hour. There are still some pretty substantial stumbling blocks or distances, but I think, and this is just my personal observation to the extent I'm allowed to have one as a UK civil servant, I think there's been some quite substantial progress in a lot of areas. But maybe I just start with the first question, a little bit around your take on where we are in the current negotiations and your understanding of what the stumbling blocks are. Maybe Bernardine, you want to start by sharing your views on that subject?
Yes, absolutely. So I think it's interesting to reprise where we are. First of all, we have left the EU. The UK has left. We left them in January. And so we've been largely living in a fiction for the last year, pretending we're still in the EU, a fiction of law. And that fiction comes to the end at 11 o'clock UK time December the 31st. And so what we've been doing in the last year, negotiating the future arrangement. The future arrangement was largely what it should have been, what it was intended to be, was set out in the political declaration. That was, you know, the framework that was agreed under Article 50. And so that was largely signposted what was going to unfold. Well, since then, there have been various departures as to what particularly the UK envisaged with that political declaration and putting flesh on that. And now we really are 5 minutes to midnight. In terms of what are we going to, you know, what is the timeline, I think is the first question, irrespective of, you know, what is in the content. And the timeline is very, very tight indeed, because certainly from a UK perspective, what we keep forgetting is that unanimity is required for this agreement. So it's all very well that we're agreeing at the moment with the European Commission. It then needs to get unanimously through 27 member states. It also needs to get through the European Parliament. And so the UK bit is actually really very simple. We're just going to ram it through European Parliament. You've got the government has a majority of 80, so it can ram it through within 24, 48 hours in emergency sessions. So you can't help but wonder, is our government not playing the clock slightly? So I think we're going to see some very, very interesting fancy footwork as to how we are going to get something that is legally binding within that period of time. And frankly, I can't see how it can be done. And so what people have been saying is, well, we could have provisional application. If we get an agreement, we can agree that provisionally apply. However, the European Parliament has to give it oversight. And this will be a very complex arrangement. It's apparently allegedly 700 pages long. And the European Parliament signaled back in the day saying, if we don't get to see it by October, we will not pass it. Please, you cannot, you know, forego democratic oversight. So I fail to see how, as people are saying, we will have an agreement and it will provisionally apply, because I think the European Parliament, as we say in Britain, would throw its toys out of the cot if we don't do that. So query whether with the situation we're in at the moment, will everybody not agree politically, legally? I think it will be a very interesting situation. will we not agree to have this, the current situation, the status quo, roll over and give ourselves some more time? And I think the British government will probably quite be relieved at that, because it gives everybody more time to finish the car park, the trailer park in Kent, or the Farage garage, as it's been called by the locals, and other details, practical details like that. So that's where we are in terms of timing. But what is a future agreement likely to contain? And I would say to you, to those of you who are very, very frightened of a non-negotiated deal, as it's being called, or others, the government is currently calling it an Australian style deal. Frankly, they might as well call it a Narnia style deal or a Sierra Leone style deal. It's a meaningless expression. It's a piece of marketing to say that, oh, it's a nice, cuddly, familiar thing. It's just, we all like Australia. We all feel it's a nice, comfortable landing place. And this weekend, Boris Johnson was describing such a non-negotiated deal as that it has a clarity and a simplicity in the approach, which has its advantages. Well, such a no deal is basically we would have no arrangements with the EU, and we would fall back onto, there are no such thing as WTO terms. That is, WTO terms is very much the basic plumbing of how we would operate. But we would basically be setting tariffs, and there would be tariffs as between ourselves and the EU. So that would be a no deal. But what if we do get an agreement, we will have is a very, very hard Brexit indeed. And so, yes, we would get quota tariff and quota free access to the EU. But the UK would be very, very much a third country. And that is a mindset which I'm afraid it's fascinating to watch. Clients need to get into the mindset. We are now the equivalent of a US or what Canada was before CETA, or Japan was before the free trade agreement. We no longer, there are a lot of freedoms that we didn't even see and we took for granted that have gone. So there's a lot we have to really go back to zero as to how we're going to be. And so many of the preparations, we have to do them in any event. So much of these changes, most of them have to be done in any event. So those of you who are sitting waiting saying, well, let's see if we get a no deal or not, I'd say, no, you need to be moving now, irrespective of what we come up with. So where are we at the moment? As I said, it's a hard Brexit. It's probably the hardest of the hard. And also services, by and large, are not covered. And we'll probably come on to what's happening with services, but they're not covered. So it is very much in and around goods. And so what are the sticking points? Three of them, we all know, the Magnusia, the level playing field, governance and fishing. I will mention fishing first to dismiss it, quite frankly. What is it about fish? And I looked up the figures last night, government figures, 747 million turnover GDP in fishing. We are 217 trillion GDP. So it's probably 0.00%, 3% of our GDP. 12,000 UK people involved in fishing, 500,900 boats. Why are we talking about fishing? It is because we all choose our battlegrounds. The UK has picked the battleground of fishing, which is where it has the most advantage, because it's basically giving access to its natural resources, 200 coastal zones, and that is where it has the maximum leverage. So of course it's left it to the end. In the political declaration, it was supposed to be resolved in July. The EU wanted that resolved first, and of course the UK have left it to the end. And of course it's emotive, it's territory, it's Britain, global Britain out in the seas, and it's great newspaper headlines. And so it's been, you know, fantastic fodder, all emotive, and we've seen this Daily Mail, most awful, awful headlines this Sunday. Merkel wants Britain to, quote, crawl across broken glass. That wasn't a quote by Merkel. So fishing is great fodder for the masses, and it will stay there, I think. But ultimately, that is going to be a numbers game. That will be resolved. Governance, again, this will probably be resolved because it's about dispute resolution. Of course, the EU in its would like the European Court of Justice to resolve the issues. The UK will wish for arbitration quite light. That's likely to be resolved. But the big, big philosophical difference between the two is in relation to the level playing field. Normally, in any trade agreement, as you know, you have a regression. Basically, you agree, I'll hold my standards at this. We will not regress back. The EU is now saying, and it probably came as a bit of a surprise to the British, we need a temporal alignment. So if our rules, if you, UK, you've told us you're going to deregulate, if you start to tank your regulations in certain specific areas, remember, the newspapers are telling it's everywhere. No, it's in specific areas, competition, state aid, social employment standards, environment, climate change, tax. if you tank your standards, we want to be able to move quickly, instantly. And I'm afraid, given with the internal market bill, there has been trust has been absolutely lost. The fact that this government was seen to be walking away from a legal commitment it made in January of this year, the trust has gone. So the UK, EU wants something very, very real. And that is where the discussions are. And who knows what is to happen as to whether they can absolutely resolve that point. So, yes, 95% of this agreement may be done and it may be being translated, etc. But it's this last little bit, a fundamental difference of philosophy. The UK is saying this is dreadful. How dare you suggest that you want to control our rule, our laws, our sovereignty? Whereas the EU is saying, listen, we can't let the UK industry into our markets, free competition, if you have an unfair cost advantage because you have tanked and you have deregulated your rules, which essentially is what you said Brexit is all about. So I've probably spoken for too long, but there is so much detail in that, but hopefully that gives you a bird's eye view of what is currently going on.
Thank you, Bernardine. Certainly feels like I pressed a button there and you had something to share. I'm not going to comment on sort of the angles and the views and the motives behind, but I do think that you gave a relatively accurate description of where things are in terms of symbolism and so forth. Again, as a UK civil servant, I'll refrain from commenting on any of that. But I have been looking at some numbers as well, and I would not certainly dispute the numbers that you were referring to. Two, you have a hand up. Please go ahead.
Thank you, Kasper and Bernardine. I agree with your light time analysis. It was very clear. Just a few follow-up points on my side. One of your points you made is that it's worth preparing anyways, notwithstanding we're going to have an agreement or not. That is a very relevant point. First of all, we don't know at all if there's going to be an agreement. And secondly, as you also mentioned, Bernardine, we don't know how the content of the agreement is going to be. It might very well end up being a light agreement. So maybe certain sectors are governed by the trade of goods agreement and certain sectors are not. And for that reason, everybody should, if they haven't already, sit down and prepare and maybe make a supply chain analysis and look at what our touch points are directly or indirectly to the UK market and where might we be touched by Brexit. So I just want to follow up on that point. And then the next thing is also on the level playing field, just also to add a bit flavor on that one, is that the single market is not only about rules and regulation, which many people might think, it's an entire ecosystem. It's an entire ecosystem of governing bodies and registrations and systems. For instance, just something like the REACH, which is the register for chemical products used within the European Union, that is more than 23,000 chemicals registered there. And if not that, if that is not part of the agreement, which seems not to be the case, then a UK importer of chemical products will have to rely on a domestic system and the UK, so the European Union company exporting to the UK market would have to register with that and all the costs belonging to that. And that raises the question if there's any room left for low volume products then in sectors hit by that. And this is just a small flavor of what's comprised by this agreement and the effects that it might have.
Thank you, Tu. I think, I mean, you do touch upon one thing which is really important, and that is to get the message out to all companies trading with the UK and to talk to them and remind them that preparations are needed. And I guess when you are mentioning chemical substances register with 23,000 substances, the way that that's in a way going to be dealt with is of course by businesses taking action and asking questions and pushing ahead. Because that means that the government will be made aware of where the most urgent points are in terms of what needs to be resolved. But I think, again, also from a UK side, I think it's fair to say that irrespective of what will be there on the 31st of December, whether it's a non-negotiated outcome, a negotiated outcome, there will still be work to be done into the new year. Maybe I want to go on with some more practical questions or talks here. One thing, I mean, we talk a lot about movement of goods. We talk about movement of people. We talk about data adequacy and so forth. But of course, having three legal companies here, maybe Andrew, I can get you to touch a little bit upon commercial arrangements and what people need to be aware of, and maybe put that into perspective of either a non-negotiated outcome or a negotiated outcome. So what do you think are the areas that companies need to focus on here, and how do they need to prepare?
Sure, thank you for that. As has been touched on earlier, we just don't know. We just don't know what's going to happen. No deal or no deal, or negotiated or non-negotiated, as you've just raised. So I think what would be advisable would be for companies to look at their contracts, as been raised before as well, and looking at whether they would still fit after the end of the transition period, such as any references to EU law or EU authorities, and any assumptions that the UK is still a member of the European Union, as has been raised before about the being a member of the EU is being part of an ecosystem. So it may not be as obvious if there may be quite implicit in the contract that's been agreed between the parties, whether there is an issue which could be affected by the transition period coming to an end. Also issues on potential import duties. That may not be raised in a contract already. If it isn't, it's something to consider with the counterparties, and maybe consider issues such as incoterms if they haven't been considered already. Also currency, we don't know what the exchange rates will be like after the end of the transition period. So if it is appropriate to maybe have some clauses which set the exchange rate, that may be useful. Also, it would be good to have an overview of jurisdiction, I would suggest, as the EU regime for that will fall away after the end of the transition period, except for cases which have begun before the end of the transition period. So what will happen after that? Things are much less certain. There may be the Hague Convention, but there would be a need of an exclusive jurisdiction agreement, and that may not be appropriate in all circumstances.
Andrew, we are losing your sound a little bit. Don't know what happened there.
I don't know when you lost me, but I was talking about jurisdiction clauses, and it may be an idea to look at those and whether exclusive jurisdiction clauses would still be appropriate under the Hague Convention, or even going away from court litigation and thinking about arbitration. Arbitration is much more flexible than court litigation, and it's not as affected by the EU regime as court litigation. So there would be some considerations.
Thank you very much, Andrew. So just apart, because you touched upon some other areas than perhaps just directly the legal arrangements that you have in place with your counterparts, but I mean certainly and it's been talked a little bit about before, that there will be customs clearance on the border between the EU and the UK, and that is something that all companies that are trading will need to prepare on. A subject which has been very hot at some points, but it's gone a little bit into the background, probably also with the agreement around the withdrawal agreement, but it's certainly also a question that we receive from time to time, and I know that you've been looking at this, Bernardine, is the Northern Ireland situation, irrespective of, can you just give a very brief description of what arrangements are in place, and of course, also for those dealing with Northern Ireland, what things should they be aware of and what should they observe?
Okay, so in brief, the situation with Northern Ireland, in a way, Northern Ireland from an EU perspective has been the equivalent of fisheries. It was something where there was a certain advantage, because it was not possible under the Good Friday or Belfast Agreement, as it's also called, to have a land border, because essentially peace was achieved in Northern Ireland by essentially wiping out the border as between the Republic of Ireland and Northern Ireland. So the UK would have been in breach of its obligations under that treaty if it was to put a land border in that, so customs border on that land border. And also, frankly, it's an impossible border. There are 300 crossings that are formal ones, probably a 300 informal ones. So it was pretty much an impossible border to man. And so what essentially this current government agreed was to put the border in the Irish Sea. And so that was also agreed under the Northern Ireland Protocol. And any disputes under the Northern Ireland Protocol would be agreed by the Joint Committee. And so what is but there's obviously a lot of ironing out because it's complicated. There's an awful lot of trade that goes between Great Britain. When we say Great Britain, we mean the United Kingdom without Northern Ireland. And so a lot of unhappiness that Northern Ireland, while it was going to stay in the regulatory regime of the EU, it would also still be part of the UK for customs purposes. So what is very, very welcome is last week there has been agreement within the Joint Committee as to how, and it's very, very temporary, I have to say, but it gives people, buys people some time as to get used to these various formalities and to, quite frankly, they're going to have to change where they procure things, especially in the field of agri-foods. So it's largely a recognition and easement up for 3 to 6 months, whereby trade the goods travelling between Northern Ireland and Great Britain will not be subject to a whole host of formalities, which would be politically unacceptable. So that is a very, very welcome move. And also the very welcome move was around state aid, because under the protocol, because the way it was a draft in quite a hurry, is that essentially it was worded in such a way whereby if the UK introduced state aid provisions and they were to affect trade in Northern Ireland and obviously would affect trade between in the EU, the EU would still have sight and able to overview the grant of UK state aid. That was completely politically unacceptable and fair enough to the UK. And so again, agreement has been, the EU has agreed that it will take into account the fact that it will only apply these rules in a circumspect way vis-a-vis Northern Ireland. And those are two big, big issues, which meant that the UK has unilaterally said, we are going to remove part five of the Internal Market Bill, which is the part of the bill which was basically offending its obligations under the withdrawal agreement. So that is very, very welcome news. Other people will say, actually, that de-risks from a political perspective the possibility of a no deal. Hopefully not. Hopefully we still do get a deal. But what is good is that there are going to be easements in place that people need to be aware. It is only a limited window of opportunity, and it largely does apply to agri-foods. And the other thing is, time and time again, we've seen people saying, oh, great, we've got some sort of hole there as between get the products into the Republic of Ireland, pop them into Northern Ireland because you've got no land border, and then you're away into Great Britain. You've got a hole there. But it is quite clear from going to the text, and there's quite a lot of them, of various declarations, they are not going to allow that sort of that hole to arise. And you really do have to establish, if you're importing goods from Northern Ireland to Great Britain, you are somebody who's absolutely established in Northern Ireland. These are the products and the fruits of Northern Ireland. So people, if you think you've got a window there, you haven't got one. So please don't think you can start that diversion. Because I always say, if it looks too good to be true, it's because it's too good to be true. So please, people should do not think of Northern Ireland as being some weak way into Great Britain or vice versa or into the EU. It's not. So that's where we are in Northern Ireland.
Caspian, you need your microphone.
Caspar, we need you to unmute. Your mic is on mute.
Oh yeah, that was one of the classics here. So we've got unmuting and legacy hands are what's happening all the time. Sorry, Bernardine, thank you very much for that. I thought it was very helpful. It's something that's gone a little bit into the background recently, but as you mentioned, there are some agreements in place. And I think one thing which is important to remind us all of here is that the border between Northern Ireland and the Republic of Ireland is not sort of a backdoor in and out of or between the UK and the EU. Now, staying on the, well, again, I mean, sort of just summarizing maybe some of the key things about movement of goods, which is really important. You need to make sure that you have a UK importer and as an exporter, you need to apply for this so-called EORI number. You need to get a customs intermediary and you need to now make sure that you pay VAT and you need to have, or you probably, your importer will probably need to apply for a duty deferment account. And then as Andrew was talking a little bit about, consider your commercial arrangements. Again, standard-wise, also refer to .gov.uk/transition, where you'll find a host of information from Her Majesty's government. Now, moving on to sort of another subject, one thing is physically moving your products across, but of course, what do you need to think about with your products? Now, Tuya, you were talking about chemical products, but maybe you can talk a little bit about also certifications and other things that you need to be aware of, potentially also country of origin. Can you share a little bit of advice in terms of what companies should be focusing on in these areas, please?
Yes, thank you. I can do that. And that is in nature of things going to be a bit more on a high level because this is a highly complex and technical area. But basically, as of today, and as mentioned earlier, the EU single market is a lot of regulation and an entire ecosystem. And as of 31st of December 2020, UK is going to depart from that. And that also has an effect on marking and product compliance and product requirements, because one of the cornerstones in the single market is that, to a great extent, the requirements are the same, so that we are sure that the products can move freely across the borders. And after 31st of December 2020, that is not longer going to be the case. Some arrangement has already been made. For instance, the CE marking has been informed that it's going to work 1 year ahead, so it's going to be until 1st of January 2022. But nevertheless, there's going to be a parallel legal book you'll have to look into if you export to the UK market. And that would be where there are some particular UK requirements in place with the UKCA government, governance body. And it's important as an exporter that you look at those rules and see if you comply with those. And in practice, your compliance departments will have to look into whether there are new requirements for your products. And if there are, of course, you have to comply with them if you export to the UK market, because you are, as an exporter, is liable to ensure that you comply with those products. And then off top of that, you mentioned, Casper, the origin of products. That is in particular relevant also when it comes to duty and duty requirements, that you have to get the paperwork in place. So it's going to be an entire paper trail you have to have in place in order to be able to export those products. So that is, like, from an overall perspective, the changes. And then if you look into how to deal with this, then of course you have to monitor whether the rules on your particular area is changing and the product requirements are changing. So that would come down to, I don't know, maybe your product compliance department would have to follow the rules and regulation on that side. On top of that, then Andrew talked a bit on it, but that in your contracts, you need to handle how you deal with this. And you could do that by agreeing that contractually, it's not a defect if you can say your products only comply with the EU regulation, then it's not a defect if it's not complying with the UK regulation. But that is, of course, a civil law thing, and that's between you and as a contract parties. And that doesn't move the risk of you being in violation of a public UK regulation. But also what we've seen some of our clients have done is that they've inserted a burden of change of law clause and say, okay, if the product requirements change from what we know today or the EU standard, then we need to renegotiate both the requirements for products, but also price, and maybe if it's a major change, you might also have to look into your lead times and see if can we actually comply with that. So maybe you need to consider whether you need an escape clause like that in your contract. Kasper, I think you're on mute.
My God. Sorry, yes, once again, I did it. So I need to, even though I put my my mouse up as a reminder. So I think there was some important points here. And what is, again, sort of in terms of structure in your heads, if you were trading, think about the actual action of moving your product across the border, but also think about what kind of rules and regulations and certifications and approvals apply to your specific product, and dig into that. That way you will be able to continue to move your product between the UK and the EU. Bernardine, I think you had your hand up.
Little practical point of what we're seeing on the ground is what has happened is the UK has basically flipped over EU law and basically said this is now retained law, UK law, and they've scrubbed out EU and put in UK. And so we're seeing a lot of glitches and things are not making sense as they should in the rules. So don't necessarily, if you find the rules aren't suiting you, it may be because they haven't really been appropriately carried over or adapted. In those circumstances, contact the regulator. The UK government and civil servants are really in listening mode at the moment. This is a fluid situation. They want to keep trade open. So please do contact your regulator and say, yeah, and say, look, we see that you're now requiring us to have an authorised representative in the UK. Is that right? And you will find that there's a lot of informal guidance that is really, really helpful and really friendly. And they may actually say, oops, you're right. Actually, we'll give you a window for 12 months, etc. So please do engage with your regulators. If you're finding there's something there that is an obstacle, don't just simply say rules is rules. You may find there is easement and movement to make it to keep that trade open. Thanks.
Thank you very, very much for that, Bernardine. And also, if you do not know who your regulator is, please get in touch with us at the British Embassy in Copenhagen, DIT. We'll be happy to go knocking on, or we'll go and knock some doors in London and see if we can help you hook up with the right people in London. And as imperfect as the situation may be, I can reassure you that we on our part and on Her Majesty's government's part are, as Bernardine was saying, very, very keen to make sure that we keep business moving. We've been talking about products specifically, but of course there is the question of people. Now, Andrew, you're a UK citizen working in Denmark, living in Sweden, so I think you are well positioned to address this subject. Could you talk to us a little bit about what things will look like in terms of movement of people, both in terms of business travel, but maybe more importantly in this forum, about what do we do when we move people across to our UK subsidiary and what should we be aware of? So if you could enlighten us a little bit on that, Andrew, please.
Of course. The simple thing is that at the end of the transition period, people need to be in the country where they want to be. If you're an employer, it's going to be much harder to employ people outside. You're not going to be able to employ people on the same terms as you can now after the transition period. So it makes sense for employees or employer and employees to get everything they can, all the evidence they have to show that they are in the particular country that they want to reside in before the end of the transition period. And also for employers to assist them with that. Potentially even helping them to move before the end of transition period, perhaps that's a little bit too tight before the end of this year, but something to consider because next year it'll be much harder for people to be employed on the same, because it won't be the same basis as now.
Thank you very much, Andrew. And maybe something to refer to here is the so-called points-based immigration system, which has been out there for quite a while. And I'm actually happy to say that it's undergone a review. So I think minimum salaries were lowered in order to allow for more people to get into the UK and work in the UK. But again, what I'm pleased to say is that the point-based immigration system is relatively simple to understand. So not as complex as many of the other documents, one being the border operating model, which is actually quite a complex document to navigate in, and one where I would probably say that most companies will need some type of legal advice to understand actually what the impact is on their business. Maybe moving on to and this again is around product, but of course in today's age, and of course us being here together virtually, the world does not run without data and transfer of data. So can you talk to us a little bit about maybe the subject of data adequacy and where things are there, and what companies need to think about moving into the end of transition period in terms of receiving and sending data between the UK and the EU?
Sure, and this is like in the periphery of my competences, because GDPR is highly detailed regulation, but from an overall perspective, once UK and the transition period expires, then it's no longer, UK is no longer part of the GDPR ecosystem within the single market, and then it's from a legal perspective considered a third country, and once it's a third country, then we need to look into regulation regulating how and under which circumstance you can share personal data and which personal data you can share with a third country, and also which safety measure has to be taken. And one very key thing here is, and you might have read about it in the press as well, is whether UK is considered an adequate jurisdiction. So that means that the EU Commission stamps the UK as an adequate jurisdiction. And that is based on the UK, from the EU Commission's perspective, is meeting certain security standards and how they treat and regulate handling of personal data. And as of today, there's, to my understanding, still no final conclusion as to whether it's going to be an adequate jurisdiction. And if it's not going to be an adequate jurisdiction, I would say if it is an adequate jurisdiction, you can carry on more or less as you can today. But if it's not an adequate jurisdiction, that you would have to look into to certain regulation which have to be in place before you can share personal data with, for instance, a UK co-contractor or UK subsidiary, and that is either by establishing an EU model contract clauses, which is available on the Commission's homepage, or you might have to incorporate binding rules within the group if it's an intra-group sharing of data, which is roughly speaking lean towards how the model contract clauses. So it's about safety and ensuring that personal data is handled in a safety manner. You might ask for a consent for the person who you're sharing the personal data is, but that is of course a theoretical solution, because go out and ask a consent for each customer, each employee you share data about, you a UK contractor or UK company, that's not going to work in practice. And then there's maybe a fourth way you can say, and we're not sure how that's going to end, and that if it's a UK privacy shield setup is being established, a bit like the one which is made with the US. And that might also be a solution. So on this point, it's important that you keep your eye on whether it's UK and actually going to be considered an adequate jurisdiction. But I think for preparation purposes, you should assume it's not going to be. And then you need to advise with your GDPR advisors as to how to handle that and have incorporated the clauses and procedures which you need to have in place in order to be able to share those data with a UK co-contractor or a group company or whoever you are sharing data with in the UK.
Thank you too. Now, since you started out by putting a little bit of caveat around the fact of saying that you're not a GDPR expert, Bernardine, Andrew, any additional comments on the subject?
I think it's very much, oops.
You put yourself back on mute, Bernardine. You got impatient as we talked about.
There we go. Back on. Yeah, it's absolutely. It's a watch the spot, because the UK was recently under the long-running Max Schrems litigation. It seems that the standard contractual clauses that were being used are not adequate. and that this guidance is being issued as to what could be done. There are more hoops to go through, but at the moment the situation is very fluid and quite uncertain, so it really is a question of watch the spot. Thank you.
Thanks. And
from my point of view, moving away from data but to intellectual property, it's also something to look at after the end of the transition period. I'm not an IP lawyer, but it's something to consider.
Well, I was just about to say, I mean, you took the word right out of my mouth, which I think is a Meatloaf song from way back. But maybe you can talk a little bit about intellectual property rights and what to be aware of here, Andrew.
As I said, I'm not an IP lawyer. I focus on arbitration.
I'm happy to jump in there just simply because I sit with all the IP lawyers and there's a big team of them here. They've issued a guidance on it. But I am told that really, because IP rights are, as you know, national, but we do have some EU rights, and that relates to trademarks and obviously EU design rights. And here what the UK legislation is doing is basically saying where you have an EU trademark or an EU-wide design right, it will be flipped into the UK system and you'll be granted a parallel UK right. And you won't have to pay registration fees, I think, for the first year. But after that, you have to re-register. So that is taken care of. Patent rights are obviously national, but the UK will no longer be part of the Unified Patents Court and Unitary Patent System. So we're out there. And then in terms of litigation, as I think Andrew said earlier, we are still signatories of the Hague Convention. You can still have exclusive jurisdiction in IP agreements. So that will go on. But because we're outside of the Lugano-Brussels Convention, we will have to fall back on common law, which is a very fluid system. We'll all be brushing out down the old case law, but never underestimate the creativity of English judges to find a solution and a way through. So if you want to dig into the detail of this, as I said, my colleagues have produced a comprehensive guide, which is available on the website, or just let me know and I can get it to you.
Thank you very much, Bernardine. Now we're sort of slowly drawing to an end. So what I'd actually like to do, I mean, I actually have a little bit of summary. But I'd like to just give each member of the panel a chance to try and really summarize as best as you can. Where do you think the key areas are for preparation? You know, what are the things that people should, I mean, if they are trading between the UK and the EU, and specifically in this context, of course, Denmark. What should they do, not tomorrow, but what should they start doing as soon as this webinar is over? I think we'll go alphabetically here as we did this morning, but the other way around. So maybe starting with you two from the sort of with the T.
Yeah, well, I think I'll make a few main points, but they're of course not going to be exhaustive, and there should also be a bit left for Andrew and Bernardine. I would as a first thing map my touch points towards the UK market, and that is of course my, if I was a company, my direct export, and find out what kind of products do I export. What are my, how do I export them? Do I export them directly, or do I do it through a seller or distributor? And are they prepared for Brexit if you do that? Check on the compliance, product compliance, and in particular, look at your contracts and see if they're ready for a fluid Brexit world. as you kind of already got from the walkthrough today, a lot of things are still moving and have been done so for so a while, and we'll probably also do that after 31st of December 2020. So make sure that your contracts are catering for the changes that might occur, and we've touched upon some of the changes that might occur, for instance, product compliance requirements, but also, for instance, pricing. If your pricing sets out certain and is based on certain assumptions as to the product requirements, then it's important that if those assumptions are changed, then you actually can sit down and have a negotiation of prices with your customer, if possible. So stuff like that. Delay, what about if there's a delay due to customs duty? Again, a lot of writing has been about the Dover border and queues with the trucks and stuff. And finally, make sure that you're ready to handle the any duties that are being imposed, so you actually have the administrative procedures in place, and having the competences in your house, and you have registered in Denmark with the Danish tax authorities, set of a guarantee scheme and things like that. I think that is, you can say, the sell part of the supply chain analysis, and then if you also have, of course, the import and delivery side of the supply chain. So where do you actually purchase your products? And are any of those things linked to UK market, touched by the link by UK market? Might there be delay? Might there be price increases and things like that? So where are you exposed on that? And also some of your suppliers are exposed towards that. So not only, you can say, a direct supply and chain analysis, but also going back a bit further to see where there might be some risk. Then I would map the risk and see how likely is it that there were going to be a change and a problem. And then I would also in that also take into account what is the impact if it actually happens. So you have like a map where you can say, okay, if there's a high impact and it's a high chance of something being changed, and then it's probably something you should start prioritizing and look into. But if there's something that's going to have a low impact and it's unlikely to happen, then I wouldn't spend time on it right now. So matters like that, and so you have a structured approach to handling the risk in Brexit. That would be my main advice here, and then I leave the field from here.
Okay, well, without further ado, Bernardine, do you want to supplement everything?
Briefly, if you're, say, from Denmark into the UK, have a look and you can Google it, the UK document called the Border Operating Model. It's about 138 pages. They're updating it constantly, explaining how it's going to work. And it's a really, really good, lucid, comprehensive explanation as to what you should be doing. And it's making clear that the easements that apply, so for the first 6 months, you don't need to complete a customs declaration. So you can start to get yourself ready. And then April, you have to start to do health certificates for food of animal origin, and then it really hits in by July. So there is time, but in the meantime, get your data together, work out the origin of your goods, of where you get your things for. So are you able to get preferential tariff treatment? Work out what the classification, the commodity code is for your goods, and also the customs value. So all of that is achievable, but I do recommend that you get hold of the Border Operating Model. And then the other thing, services, we've not really covered that. Services really aren't, by and large, necessarily covered by EU law. So you're now, from a UK perspective, going to be looking at, well, what are the individual countries doing vis-a-vis services, mutual recognition of qualifications, that's gone. So what can you do? What freedom of movement do you have? And there, I'm afraid, we are probably likely to fall back on the WTO rules. So it's very complex. You're going to have to work out what is the service, and there's a whole list of different possible services. Then you ask yourself, what country am I supplying that service into? What has that country put into the WTO in terms of schedule, and what easements between the mode 1 to 4 is in place? Because we are used as UK to all of those things are free and freely available. Now it's just more tricky. Where what box can you get yourself into? But ultimately, it's achievable. You've just got to kind of work your way through it, and it's a cold hand on your head time. So that's all I want to say.
Thank you very much, Bernardine, and thank you for bringing the matter of services up. Clearly, that's important. Especially, it's important, of course, for the UK in terms of how, if we're looking at how trade between the UK and Denmark is distributed. So thanks for pointing that out. Andrew, have we left anything for you to remind us of, or have your colleagues been completely adequate in what they've been mentioning?
I agree with what's been said before. There's not much to add. No, I would just say that contracts, look at the contracts, make sure that they are as ready as they can be for whatever happens after the transition period. looking at the jurisdiction clauses as well, and as been mentioned before, doing a risk assessment and seeing what are the priorities for your particular business.
Yeah, and I think it's probably worth mentioning that if you haven't done these things yet, I would argue that it's not too late doing them, and you should make sure that you prepare and do it with urgency. Once again, I'd like to flag Copenhagen Embassy DIT as a place where you can ask, and that would especially be to get connected with the right people and the right departments in London. Now, I'll sort of shortly, I'll be rounding up a little bit here. I think one thing that is really worth mentioning, Gunnar, did you want to come in or?
There was actually just one question I thought would be good to bring up here in plenary, but otherwise let people take the questions in the breakout in a moment. There was something about how can you elaborate on business travel, on visas requirements for non-UK travellers. For that sake, if you are a board member of a UK company, but you're not a UK citizen or resident, maybe you could also take that question reverse. What if you're a UK resident and you're a board member in Denmark, for example? I think that's a good point, maybe just to briefly bring up here, if possible.
Sure. Anyone who wants to comment on that? I mean, I can remember some of it, but I can't remember the detail. I think I've seen a slide with an overview. Who wants to volunteer on that one?
Well, I can give it a go. Basically, what this is about is, you can say, short-term business traveling. So you're traveling into the UK or the EU and to do some work and then traveling out again. And the regulation, to my understanding, is going to be based on UK and EU regulation and which requirements is set up in each jurisdiction. But what I've read so far is that there seems to be an agreement on that short-term business traveling would not require an exact visa. So if I read something about 3 months, but I haven't seen it ironed out in regulation so far. But I think you could assume that short-term business traveling is going to be rather freely to do going forward. But we need to see the exact agreement on these things before you can say I can say it for sure.
Thank you, Chu. I think from memory, the document I saw, it's actually 6 months.
Oh, I'm a lawyer, so.
That's fine. Okay. A couple of things here, and this would actually, well, a pointer to somewhere, a place where you can find a lot of information is the .gov.uk pages. Bernardine was talking about Googling the border operating model. You can go into .gov.uk and you can search for border operating model. You'll get that. You can search for points-based immigration system and you will get that. And you can actually search for a lot of things. It's very dynamic at the moment. So there is new information added all the time. I think sort of the final words from my end will be just a reminder, because I think sometimes you can get a little bit lost in all of the complexities around end of transition period and Brexit. And I also think that we're all in many ways affected by it. If we are sort of working closely in sort of the area of exchange between the UK and the EU, and in this specific case, the UK and Denmark. And I think we're all crossing our fingers that eventually we will have a negotiated outcome as opposed to a non-negotiated outcome. I think we've all gotten used to the idea of the UK leaving the EU, and you can feel and think whatever you want to about that, but I think that's a fact. But one thing which I would like to remind us of, and that's what I remind myself of once in a while, because of course you can imagine that I'm exposed to a lot of information, is that Denmark is trading on a daily basis with third-party countries. Goods and services are moving between Denmark and third-party countries, and Again, I don't have the exact stats because I'm mainly looking at UK-DK relations, but to the best of my knowledge, I think the biggest trading partner for Denmark these days is no longer Germany, which it used to be, and I think UK was number one some years back. I think it's actually the US that's the number one trading partner for Denmark. So there is a lot of knowledge and expertise and systems in place. Of course, when a country goes from being an EU member to becoming a non-EU member, which is the first time, of course, it's complicated to do the transition. But I just like to remind us all that trade is taking place, and also between UK and third party countries. So of course we can make this work. Of course, a lot easier with a negotiated outcome. I think I'll end it on that note, and I will hand back to Gunnar. And thank you very much from my end for the panelists and for providing a lot of, I think, very important insights on end of transition period preparations for companies trading between Denmark and the UK, or the EU and the UK. But thank you very much, Gunnar, and I'll hand back to you. Bye.
Thank you. Bye. Thank you very much, Kasper. Really brilliant for your moderation here. We're not done yet. There's now a chance for all of you to ask more detailed questions. Just a second, I'm going to hand over to my colleague to explain how to do that. However, just briefly, for more information on all of what's been said today, you'll find links on our event pages to the respective legal firms, to DIT. For that sake, a lot of other members advise on how to go about still continue trading from January and onwards. But moving on, Kira from the British Chamber of Commerce in Copenhagen, will you take the lead and show us how we get into the breakout rooms, please?
Yes, I'd be happy to do so, Gunnar, and thank you so much to all our speakers. That concludes the main session of today, and we will now move into the break.